have here tonight two of the most formidable writing machines in the world. This is no more to suggest that their work is standardized than it would follow from the observation that Bach wrote a cantata every fortnight or so, that his music was routinized. One of them has been called by one literary critic the finest living American novelist. I shan't say which one it is, leaving it for you to decide after you read their work. Miss Maclnnes was born and educated in Scotland. She studied just about everything in Glasgow University, which is a good way to prepare yourself to become Mrs. Gilbert Hyatt, which is what she is in real life, married to the famous chairman of the classics department of Columbia University. Miss Maclnnes's first smash triumph was Assignment in Brittany, perhaps the greatest spy story of the world. 12 books later, her book is The Salzburg Connection, which is even now leading the bestseller list. Mr. Lewis Auchincloss also has a novel on the bestseller list. It is called A World of Profit, and some think it is his very best. Having written 14 books, the 15th should certainly be good, or else it's time to quit. Mr. Auchincloss is a graduate of Yale and of the Law School of the University of Virginia. Incredibly, he still practices law, notwithstanding his literary output. Perhaps his intention is to undermine legal prose by introducing some English into it. We are here to discuss the plight of the American novelist, and I should like to begin by asking Miss Maclnnes, how does she account for the apparent decline of interest in fiction?
Perhaps nonfiction has more things of more excitement coming from real life than is it put into some of the current writing in modern novels. It may be that...
It's the fault of the novelist, not of the world.
Well, of the subject matter. I do hear constantly from people who are critics or connected with the publishing world and who really love publishing fiction, and they're all, or reading fiction, and they're all very crushed. Actually, more fiction books are being sent to the publisher, I believe, more of the typescripts are being sent every year, and more have to be turned down because they're either poorly written or ill-conceived, or they're all kind of redundant, or they're always repeating the same kind of theme. Many of them seem to be have a fixed interest, which is in the writer himself or herself, and perhaps a little of reactions of people to them, or their reactions to people, but it's all it's that kind of thing, which is as if imagination and scope and plot and certain depth of knowledge doesn't seem to come into them anymore.
But wouldn't that suggest that that good fiction would, under the circumstances, sell more? That is to say, if you are saying that the demand for fiction has not diminished, but that the demand's standards are higher than the output of our writers, would this suggest that people who write good novels will sell many more of them than they would have, say, 15 or 20 years ago when they were in greater competition? Or is this, in fact, the case?
I think people do sell. People who do get bought and published do sell more now, I think, than perhaps they did before, although I think the actual quantity sold is lower in proportion to the nonfiction books, which have increased in, well, they've become more interesting. At one time, non-fiction books seemed to be rather heavy and dull and something you did, you know, to make a resume of for perhaps something, a course in college. Mm-hmm. And were very heavy, and the papers you went through were very, very, very studgily written. But non-fiction now has some excellent writers, and they're putting things to us that, and about subjects too, which interest us a great deal and hold our interest. It's, you see, a novel has really got to interest people before they're going to read it and enjoy it. And where novels sell, I really believe, is that people talk to each other and say, you know, I really enjoyed that book.
Mm-hmm. And word of mouth.
And word of mouth.
Yeah.
And publishers will tell you that pays off far more than anything Madison Avenue ever thought of.
Mm-hmm.
Just people speaking about what they've read or what they have seen in the way of a play or a theatre.
Well, in terms of the actual sales, what, for instance, would be the sale of a typical Maclnnes novel?
Well, this
In America.
In America.
In America, yeah.
Well, this is just published in September. The last hardcover sales, which I heard about 2 or 3 weeks ago, was then about well over 100,000.
And soft cover?
Well, that doesn't come out till later.
No, I say, how many would you expect?
I never know. They go out in large numbers.
Uh-huh. Now, this
I'm awfully bad at statistics in my own novels.
Mm-hmm.
I've never written with the idea of how many I'm going to sell. Mm-hmm. I never thought of, and it's perfectly honest, my husband will bear me out. I've never thought of even bestseller lists, and I think it's madness to think of such things.
I wasn't asking so much for that reason. Yes. I was asking because I'm aware that during the 30s, a book could achieve the bestseller list with far fewer sales
yes.
than now, which seems to bear out the thesis
yes.
that people are still hungry for good novels.
Well, my first novel, for instance, was Above Suspicion.
Yes.
The second
I said, I said your first triumph.
Well, it was my very first novel. And now, roughly, I don't know, because it's gone into a lot of editions since, and it's still being in new editions, both hardcover and the paperback. And just newly been put out in Britain in hardcover all over again, which is very nice. So there you are. You see, I've got to think of an expanse of how many. Published 1941.
Mm-hmm.
That's an expanse of how many years. But in its first year of publication, I remember being absolutely dazzled and baffled at the whole thing. And somehow or other, I think it sold something round about. In the first year, I'm not sure. I'd have to go and ask my publisher. But in its hardcover life of its very first half year, from July until, might have been about 20 or 30,000.
Mm-hmm. And 40,000,
I'm not sure,
yeah.
and so forth. And then it goes on and yeah. on. One of the nice things is that every 10 years, a new reading public comes up. Mm-hmm. And they do read the first books as well as the last.
Mm-hmm.
Which that is what makes me happy, really happy.
Mr. Auchincloss, do you have comments that you want to make on the points that Miss Maclnnes touched on? Also feel that the failure is out of the novelist rather than of the reading public?
Well, I might question whether or not there really is a failure in this plight, because it's certainly true that nonfiction in the trade book departments has gone way up over fiction, but isn't it largely in hardcover? Now, actually, more people in the last 15 years have been reading novels than ever before in the history of the world. It's not only because population is larger, it's because of the colossal paper sales. And it seems to me that, I mean, where a novelist even not a very well-known novelist can possibly sell in the hundreds of thousands in paper, well, mm-hmm. those people read just as much as hardcover.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the future of the novel is going to be almost entirely in paperback, because I don't think people, by and large, want to pay $5.95 and $6.95 for a novel, and yet they feel that if they buy a biography of Marie Antoinette, they can put it on their shelf forever.
Sure.
But the novel will be thrown away.
Well, isn't this rather depressing news for authors, in as much as their royalties off paperbacks are pretty exiguous?
No, because the paperbacks have been supporting authors.
Not this author.
Yeah,
but many
ones.
I think it would be simply a matter of general interest for people who don't know to discover that an author gets approximately, 3 or 4 cents from the sale of a dollar paperback. Isn't that right?
But he usually sells outright. It's usually for a sum certain that he sells.
Excuse me?
He usually doesn't sell by the copy. He usually sells the book outright. And they've been giving fantastic prices.
No, that's only very rare. Very rare,
yes. He's very, very, very rare.
You'll get
the author
just a few cents, and it's the quantity of sales that does it, they say.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, to your publisher, get his 50-50 split on that, on what
that
you make.
That will probably change.
Well, the authors have been trying to change that, but the publishers don't really have got to say that it would spoil business foundations.
No, I'd like to understand you. Is it your point that if one were to do away completely with hardcovers, it would still not damage the availability of sufficient fiction to feed the national appetite, because authors would go right into soft cover?
Yes, and some authors do. Some novels do come out in original paperback now, and I think we'll see more and more of that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
In fact, I think we'll come to the time very soon where it'll be like in France and so many European countries, where you come out in paperback, and then if the novel holds itself, You will have a hardcover edition for those who want to keep it.
But there's restrained paperback. I remember long ago, when before I came to America, before I wrote novels, I was married to an Oxford don, Gilbert Hyatt. And in the summers, we would, trot over, do some mountain climbing in the Tyrol or someplace, and come back through Paris. And we always stocked up in the French books because we could get the paperback, and they were all white. White, plain white, because you were to bind them yourself. We never did. Mm-hmm. You bind them yourself, or have them bound, rather, if you liked the book well enough to keep and put up on your library shelf. But they were rather restrained and rather nice type, and they looked rather elegant. And also, we used to buy a lot of what we called Penguin, because in these days, there were no paperbacks, no reprints at all like that. And Penguins were, but they were not allowed to be sold in England because it would destroy the market for hardcovers in England. So we used to try and smuggle them in to clear a few and say to the customer, really, couldn't we just get these in? Because I agree with you, ever since I've been to college, I said prices of books are far too high, except they've got to cost that because it's not just the author that's getting it and it's not just the publisher's getting it, but it's the people who make the paper and sell the paper, and it's the people who do the type and all the lithographers and everything else. And it's all that, and the bookbinding and the glue and everything else costs money, and prices have gone up. And I think that when publishers try to hold the line in price, they really do make an effort to do it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's just one of these things that gets priced out the market, just the way that theatre tickets have gone up far too high in price because costs are too high.
Mm-hmm.
But perhaps we're being a little too mechanical about your original question about whether or not there is a whether or not the basic demand for the novel is something that satisfies readers today has diminished. And I think you were addressing yourself more to that, whether or not the novel fulfills some essential role.
Well, why do people take less satisfaction from novels than they used to do? Surely it has something to do, for one thing, with the availability of alternative ways of spending one's time. Television would be the principal enemy, I suppose. But another conceivably might be that the current appetite is for something that gives you quick, continuous sensations, that there isn't the kind of a spirit that obtained in another age that gave you the disposition to, say, engage a Dickens or a Trollope or a Jane Austen, somebody who would take his or her time in taking you through a considerable experience. Now, there are people who buck that particular trend. You certainly are one of them, but you get a lot of flack for it too, don't you?
Yes, well, I think that there is, in the other arts, of course, there's a great demand, there's a constant demand for forms that are relevant to our age. And the screen and painting and sculpture can change its form. Now, you see, the novel tried to change its form, and the French novel carrying it to the point where Nathalie Sarraute has eliminated characters. And plot is, of course, commonly eliminated today. But it seems to me that the novel is not capable of the adjustment of new forms. There isn't so far you can go. I really don't think Nathalie Sarraute is successful in eliminating characters.
Well,
she's
writing a novel. Why doesn't she call it something else? She is writing. Well, let's call it something else. And of course, that's always been the tragedy. So many people think that novel, we do recently, they never thought of this before. If you study any of the literatures, you know, of English literatures going back, people never got confused in their minds about what the novel was for. The novel was a certain form. And if they were good at being essayists, they wrote essays. Or if they were poetic, then they would rarely concentrate on writing long poems, not the lyrics, not short poems, but really long odes, long, long poems. And,
excuse me. Oh, Miss McInnes, I interrupted you, sorry.
I guess perhaps we have tried to do too much with the novel. Rather, it isn't the only way of writing, and I think that other forms of writing are just as good. And that people perhaps might even be non-fiction writers, or they may be playwrights, they may be poets, they may be essayists, they may be prose satirists.
Well, I know that the Norman Potter, the journalist and editor of commentary, said recently that journalism was the highest art form of our time, to which, however, somebody observed this was a little bit like a hairdresser saying that hairdressing is the highest art form of our time. Surely the case for the novel continues, But is it true, do you think, that the reception of a novel is more and more dictated by the reviewer's ideological tendencies, by his feeling that it must make social realism, that it must contribute a point that is instantly transferable into the currency of social reform and that kind of thing? Does that get in the way?
I don't think terribly much, no, because I think that some of the most significant, certainly some of the most popular serious novels have not shown any particular newness of form.
Like for
Catherine
instance,
Ann Porter, mm-hmm. Ship of Fools, which she embraces the colossal.
Yeah,
she's
about 125 years.
Yes. Terrifically.
What's that?
She isn't being, she isn't making a speech in a soapbox to her novel.
No, but I think maybe it's a bad example of it, because what's so wonderful about Catherine Ann Porter is precisely that she's anomalous, that she is one of the few things like the Antimacassar in your living room that doesn't change.
Yeah.
But what about a typical novelist?
I think it cripples him.
Who feels free? Are you the only example?
Of what?
Of somebody who defies the dictum that novels have got to sort of engage.
We've got to keep changing their form. We've got to.
And they've got to be socially useful.
Well, that isn't quite the word they use, is it? Usually relevant.
Yeah, relevant. Yeah.
You know what Mary McCarthy said, that the trouble was that the novel grew up in an age of basic common sense, and great big long novels by Dickens and Thackeray and Trollope were basically about a very common sense world.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, our world doesn't make any sense, and therefore it's not the world for the novel. And that's a very sweeping statement, but I think there's more in it than almost anything that I know about the plight of the novel.
Why does our world make less sense than the world of the 19th century?
No,
it seems to me that
the time
confusions,
of the Industrial Revolution,
the
1648 rebellion, revolts.
I think possibly those things were more subject to taking a piece, a slice off, and studying it dramatically than the world tensions of today.
Not really.
Sure,
if you really applied yourself to the world tensions, you could make a thorough, very depressing, but complete study of many of them.
Sure. I think
went back into the past in his last and best novel.
Yeah.
To take a segment, a study of slavery, and wrote, I think, to my mind, it's the most terrific novel of the past 10 years, and it's an historical novel.
Mm-hmm.
This interests me very much.
Well, lots of novels have got this.
But doesn't it strike you as possibly the case that the 20th century, being the century of where the intellectual and romantic odysseys usually begin from yourself, and end up with yourself. It becomes, therefore, the age of solipsism. Only you are interesting.
That is.
Whereas
it.
Before, God was interesting,
yeah.
Nature was interesting, humanity was interesting.
And
that under the circumstances, a novelist more often than not finds that, on the one hand, he is interested exclusively in himself, but he wants his readers also to be interested in himself. Therefore, he's asking his readers to violate his own rules. Now, for instance, Norman Mailer is interesting. But suppose he weren't.
Well,
it would be absolutely terrible.
Then that's where you get the novels, the ones that get turned down. As I said, they weren't interesting enough. That's what I've been told.
I've read an awful lot of them that weren't interesting.
You mean that are saturated with an uninteresting personality?
Well, no, I really do think, if looking back at the history novel, there came a point when people suddenly discovered the interest of writing about yourself, and it was marvellous when it was begun, first and done very well. And sort of less need for plot and more as the observer and interested in people, your reaction to people to you.
Mm-hmm.
This got to the point when I remember about 20 years ago, 30 years ago, people were saying, what's wrong with the novel? You know, we must drop plot. That's obviously old hat and all the rest of it. So the procedure to do this kind of thing, whether this is a result of teaching people how to write novels at various places, and whether these theories we put in. So the old idea, a novelist is really a storyteller. And as I say, if you don't want to be a storyteller, you want to be something else,
be a journalist,
then find another form of writing.
Yeah.
And there are good forms and authentic forms. It's just rather silly to think everything's got to be done through the novel.
Sure. I'd like to ask Mr. Auchincloss, if it won't embarrass him, to analyze a couple of sentences, highly critical sentences, of his last book. This particular gentleman called Rhodes says, if I were the rector of Dresden, the rector of Dresden is, as you know, one of Mr. Auchincloss's most famous books about a legendary schoolmaster. If I were the rector of Dresden and young Louis Auchincloss were my pupil, I think I would hand his manuscript back to him and ask for something with a little more heft, a little more respect for the grace of God, who did not put us on this earth to be full-time fools, or at least a little more respect for the grace of fiction, the rules of which I had thought were well known. What's he talking about?
I don't know. I haven't heard that before.
But I didn't improvise it.
I'm sure you didn't. I was quite interested.
But now, a little more heft, would you suggest that this means that he thinks that you deal with trivial themes?
Well, it has often been said.
Mm-hmm. Well, is a novel of manners necessarily devoted to trivial concerns? I haven't
heard
that.
Well, you run into a terrible risk of being judged according to your characters and what they're doing. Yeah. Unless you're dead.
Yeah, then you can get rid of
then you're Proust. Yeah. Nobody ever says that the life of the Duchesse de Guermantes is trivial.
Yeah.
It's absolutely perfect. But when you're alive, you run into that trouble. And he did when he was alive.
Well, we can't do anything about that as far as you're concerned. when this reviewer refers to a little more respect for the grace of fiction, the rules of which I had thought were well known, what do you suppose he has in mind? He obviously has in mind as something that we ought to know right away, correct?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if the rules are well known, we should know them, right?
Mm-hmm.
What are they?
Well, I certainly don't know. I'm usually accused of writing too much by rules.
Mm-hmm.
As for grace, I don't know.
Is the novelist very, very frequently dismayed by a notice of this kind? Does that put you off, or have you ever had a bad review?
Oh, yes.
You have?
Well, critical reviews are...
Mm-hmm. What is your sin, from his
well,
point of view?
Well, they sometimes vary. The same book was very interesting. I don't know whether they were doing it from really doing the novel, or whether they just didn't like the way my thesis or my politics. I don't know. But for the same book, two people writing said, well, one was that this is scarcely worth reading. There's no plot at all. The next one said, this is scarcely worth reading. I mean, they had the same phrase to begin with. Scarcely worth reading. There's so much plot you get lost. So I just I thought, well, really, no, the critics you really value are ones who are pointing out something that is really extremely serious and you realize is very valid, and that's okay.
The ones who isolate all of your virtues.
The point? No, that's very nice. It's very nice if people do appreciate a point. Mm. And if you pick up something that you had slipped in there, hoping that one in a thousand might see it and understand it, and they'd get it.
Somebody with a jeweler's eye.
Yes, that's a...
Mr. Auchincloss, one reviewer of your last book said that there are actually people in it that the reader suspects you like. I was rather surprised at that, because I found people in your other novels that I sort of thought you liked,
yes.
Or at least who I thought were like like a bull. But is it your own notion that the age of the anti-hero requires the novelist who wants to be fashionable to always floor his characters in such a way as to make them all sort of roughly despicable? I've read an awful lot of novels in which there isn't a single ingratiating character in it, haven't you?
Yes.
And is this something that is distinctly of our time?
No, do you think so?
Oh,
but
yes.
Balzac was
I think it's another character. Fashion. But he had other people, too.
Not always. Sometimes they're all awful.
Well, that's one of the reasons why fewer people read them than they'll read Tolstoy, for instance. I mean, people read War and Peace, Anna Karenina,
mm-hmm.
or Dostoevsky, because at least,
I
mean, even with the flawed
Bob
characters
Balzac,
or weak characters or ugly
soul.
Characters, you will also get people who have got something that for people to admire or
I
like.
It's necessary. I think
or
quality
sympathize
is every...
with. Well, it's very difficult to sympathize with someone who's really a monster. And when monsters are put in, and Balzac had several of his monsters in, it's very difficult to feel any warmth.
I can be interested in Macbeth.
Well, if
was
you think...
Was it nice in Macbeth?
Oh, yes, there were some nice
characters.
There were some minor characters.
Yes, and the young
the witches.
Boy.
Malcolm.
do you feel that cynicism... And I take it that it is generally agreed that we live in a cynical age, that it is therefore always assumed that the good guy is actually in search of some oblique objective, or else he is being good merely because his glandular impulses require him to be good in a temporary situation. Is there a good guy in Catch-22, for instance?
Well, I always think cynics assume too much about the human race.
Well, I agree with you, but we are inquiring to the plight of the novelist, and it seems to me that there might be novel writers who would like to write about somebody lovable.
Well, I don't see. If they're a storyteller, let them write about this. Let them write.
Will they make out? Will they be credible?
If they're a novelist, yes. Mm-hmm. I mean...
It seems to go
if
to extremes,
you're a novelist,
the other
you're going to write a novel. And so my point was that novels that fail and are and make people unhappy who put all their hopes into writing them, and then they are crushed. It's because they aren't a novelist, but I'm saying cheer up, fellows. You don't have to be a novelist. I don't think even the novelists are the greatest people on earth. Novelists are okay, but there are other things you can do with your writing talent, and this is not one of them. You aren't a storyteller. You're not the novelist. And I think, as I said, we're trying to stretch it when we started saying, where's the novel going, and putting other things, and then a fashion came along, and we seized one side where plots and things were totally disregarded. And of course, when you don't use imagination and you think you've got to go around with a little notebook and taking people down from real life, which is not really necessary at all for a novel, I don't believe it's the way to write a novel. I think if you don't have imagination, and enough breadth of vision and anything else to create a story and characters, then think if you're a good essayist or a columnist or what, perhaps a poet. We need more poets, goodness knows.
Well, does the demand generate the supply here? Suppose there were a considerable appetite for fine fiction, would it follow that fine fiction would sort of grow out of the loins of an obliging society?
Well, until the novelist, someone who can tell a story, tell it well, and write in a way in which it flows, in which the story flows, the characters are there. If there's something strange and remarkable, you can't guess it. You shouldn't be able to guess a novel right through. I mean, and I'm not meaning you're keeping clues from people. That's ridiculous, you know. Mm-hmm. But I mean, really, you should. The unexpected should come along in developments and in reactions. And at the same time, looking back on it, it's perfectly...
You should tell who Rod really is.
No, not that. No. Because I'm not really very interested in any question of who did it or who done it.
I think the demand could create the novelist because, I mean, writers are writers, and any... Well, I wouldn't say any, but almost any really good accomplished author, if he felt the right idea and the desire, could write a novel. And I think writers can go back and forth between the theater.
You disagree with Miss Maclnnes, who says that only a good storyteller can write a good novel?
Yes, I do disagree with that.
Uh-huh. You think
I think storytelling is a very good idea and to play down today, but I don't think it's...
Play fine, huh?
I don't
what
think
about somebody like John Kenneth Galbraith? For instance, he is a good writer. Did he write a good novel?
He did write a novel, didn't he?
I say, yes, did he write a good novel?
Well, I didn't read it.
No.
You didn't read it?
No. Well, but I don't think Ulysses has what I call a story, and I think it's a very good novel.
It's a tour de force.
A tour de force can be a novel.
And there's much more in Ulysses, actually, than
I think you take your life in your hands when you throw the plot out the window because the chances are you become terribly boring when you do that. But I don't say it can't be done, and there isn't a novel when you've done it.
You think that a novel survives simply because it adopts a fictional form? Or when you say novel, you mean
well, I define the novel much more broadly. I define the novel than Miss Maclnnes does. I define the novel as E.M. Forster did when he said it's a prose work of more than 30,000 words.
Oh, come on.
No, he had one other quality. I'm too broad.
Well, yeah, we could really start the history of the English novel long, long, even before
I've left. I've left out something, but it's so broad. And if you do, if any time you try and cut it down, you have to leave out some obviously good novel. So I think we'll just leave it large and messy.
And even there are many novels, people who don't believe the novel has got a special form, and I think it's got very, not a narrow form, very broad form, because if you think of all the varieties of novelists, from Jane Austen to Dickens, to Solzhenitsyn, all the American novelists that we have read and we brought up with and so forth, and they are, always wrote in the form of the novel. They weren't playing around with the novel.
Yeah, sure.
And it's something that's so broad that you can say it's got this special thing. And when you start bringing in everything, then you're really getting back to the days when there were an awful lot of different prose works written, but they were not novels. I mean,
yes,
Rabelais prose, but it's not a novel. Mm-hmm. And the people prior to Maclnnes, even I call Maclnnes a kind of picaresque novel because it was.
I'd certainly call it a novel.
but the things earlier than that were definitely not ever considered novels, but they just don't.
Well, let me ask you this: do you think that as a rule of thumb, the finest novels do not find a universal readership, but are appreciated more by the very small minority? Or do you believe that it's one of those few and blessed art forms in which a truly successful novel makes it among a lot of people?
I think the best novels have almost always, with certain terrific exceptions you can think of, found a very wide audience.
Yeah. What would be an exception?
I suppose Flaubert with Madame Bovary, but even that was, I mean, he had a small audience for a while, but he had a terribly enthusiastic, passionate audience. Mm-hmm. And then it grew enormously.
And it spread, yes. It was like a pool that spread into a large
lake. But he thought he was a failure for a little while after it came out.
No, I don't think that any small group has got a monopoly on reading.
Well, can you think of a contemporary novelist about whom there is a solidarity of critical support, who is also a tremendous seller?
Who's also a tremendous bestseller?
Yeah.
Oh, lots of
them. Oh, yes, yeah. Saul Bellow.
Yeah. Is he a tremendous bestseller?
Tremendous bestseller. Yeah. And has absolutely unanimous critical support.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Styron. Mailer doesn't have unanimous critical support, but he has an awful lot of support. He's getting more and more.
Actually, he's not a particular bestseller, really.
Oh, I think he is now.
Yeah. Well, what was the name of the Frenchman who said, whether a novel makes money or doesn't make money is no proof of either success or unsuccess.
Malibu gets very good press and great success and every prize.
No, there are some snobs, you know, we have around, and I think they hold back the novel, or we're talking about the novel, so let's stop. Writing in general, but novel. This little snob feeling, and it's an awfully bad one, and we don't like being snobs, do we? So we try to resist it. And but it's there, and it's simply that if you are popular,
you're no good.
You can't be good. Yeah. Now, this is just ridiculous. The French saw through this very quickly. They've got quite sharp minds and literary criticism, and they saw through this at once. But it's just the same thing. Such people are really displaying the most extraordinary ignorance and sense of when books, through the whole history of literature, and let's go back 2,000 years, when things are being transmitted, to begin with the poems which were spoken, because nothing was written down until 800 BC, and when Homer was first put into print, as it were, that is written down for the first time then, obviously there were lots of other poems being spoken around all the halls. It was their one entertainment, their one thing of keeping the myths alive and all the great tales. And it's only the ones that were really popular got put down and transferred into the new medium of writing. Then when that transferred
from
papyrus Even that, from the papyrus people, for instance, that were going into vellum and sort of thing, it was the ones that had been read off and had most copies around, so that those who were left in literature could copy them. And when at the end of the Dark Ages, when the devoted monks had copied again, and then we were coming into paper and printing, again that big transfer over, it was what makes the libraries that we have now of the classics or of all the books in
but
Europe.
The trouble with that demonstration is that it leaves us not knowing what it is that we were not vouchsafed. It's hard to imagine that there was somebody greater than Homer
who
wasn't.
He was progressed, but into later ones, and Sophocles' plays and things, which did never made out of the burnings and the barbarians.
Mr. Greenfield, you have a question.
First, since you've mentioned Catch-22, which is, I guess, one of my favorite novels, I think it's arguable that Yossarian and the Chaplain are two eminently decent fellows trapped in that terrible world.
No, they just appear to appeal certain kinds of people.
Yossarian does finally get out of that madness, and the Chaplain's always trying to maintain some sense of rationality about him, and I think it is arguable, if you wish to say it's not arguable, I can leave, but it's arguable that they're eminently decent fellows. I wonder
It is arguable, sure.
Thank you. First Amendment trial.
And you will argue
again, yes. since Maler seems to have achieved his latest critical acclaim by moving away from the novel into this personal journalism frame of reference, I wonder if it isn't possible to suggest that because we can talk more frankly now about real people and real events than was true 100 years ago, that perhaps if not the decline in fiction, then the immense rise in the readability and the excitement of nonfiction is pinpointed to just that, namely that we know about people's, or we think we know about people's psyche, we know Freud, we know their sexual drives and the personal ambitions we can talk about. And somehow that seems to be more exciting than to write even about spies or successful
lawyers. Do our novelists know more than Shakespeare did about the human nature?
That's what I'm suggesting, but I wonder if Shakespeare...
Oh, no.
No. I'm suggesting that if Shakespeare had been around today, he might have preferred much more talking about the clash between two real-life senators and spending a month in the Senate gallery and writing the equivalent of...
But why do you think Mailer is so much... is so much freer today than he would have been, say, 100 years ago? I mean, do you think in Miami and the Siege of Chicago, he can say more about, maybe a little more, about Mr. Nixon or Senator McCarthy than he could have said about Disraeli or Gladstone?
And gotten away with it, yes.
Well, but does he?
No.
Yes, I think he does.
I don't think so.
I think what he says is very extremely interesting and brilliant, but I think that you could find things said about people in the 19th
century.
Well,
now that's the question.
He doesn't go into the sexual drives of the candidates.
Oh, well, without getting too risque on this program, the whole aura of Miami... That whole sense
Miami.
He has, but that whole sense of that plastic, artificial, sensual climate is discussed
true.
In a way in which it suggests that he has learned something that maybe we would not have thought about 100 years ago and applied to it a novelist's eye in a way which gets a synthesis that's very, very different.
Well, I think it's really very graphic writing, but I don't think it's only possible in the 1960s.
I think he teaches us more about Miami than Dickens taught us about London.
And about the law.
Exactly.
No, but for that was right.
Dickens 100 years ago used the storytelling form for that, that people who are concerned about that now, rather than using the storytelling frame of reference, use a realistic one.
Well, don't call it a novel.
I was saying
let's not call them novels.
I don't suggest it's a novel at all.
But just another way, and let's invent a good name for any new forms that we develop.
No,
Mr.
I'm sorry.
Greenfield is suggesting that the people who would have written, who would have adopted the novel form in other years, now don't need to do so because non-fiction prose admits a breadth of view.
Oh, no, Macaulay was writing non-fiction fiction prose. And, if you just go right back to the of the 19th century literature, you'd find just the same amount of people writing non-fiction prose, too, and excellent stuff.
But as you said...
And Naylor has certainly not given up fiction.
Novelists were really the minority then, you know, in many of the important books that
But as you
produced.
Said, somehow the non-fiction has become much less of a deadened form than we have previously thought of it. I was suggesting, obviously, to be beaten back unanimously. One of the reasons was because of the freedom.
I think it's reached an impasse in many ways, so it may have killed itself, and that deadening form in itself in going after what you talk about. I thought it would be much better if it had used, we're all different individuals from the people who were writing 50, 100 years ago, and we have different problems, different ideas, everything. That adds interest and individuality. And we can't, the force of that individuality is very great. We don't have to always be experimenting. And I think we might learn something from the scientists anyway, who experiment, but don't consider this the end of a thing. Right. And they'll go through 800 experiments in order to invent the telephone and say, well, at least we know 800 ways in which it can't be invented, or the electric light or something, and see that. You give up when an experiment doesn't work.
Yeah,
the trouble about both art today, literature today, we often have experiments and we hang on to them even when they aren't working. We should be more like the scientists and cut our losses. And it's rather hard, I know.
Take off our new tack, yeah.
But there are plenty of other experiments to try.
Miss Williams.
I'm torn between a couple of everything seems to be running in so many different directions. But one of the things I would think about Miller is that the real difference is that he has very definitely and in an honest way introduced himself and implicated himself in every sentence of his work. This doesn't happen with the novelist. As you said, Mr. Auchincloss, very often people want to identify you with your characters when you're not, you know, you do not necessarily reflect their views and so forth. Mr. Buckley, your objection to new forms of fiction seemed to be a solipsism. And I wonder if you think that in an age which is as provisional as ours, which values are constantly changing, in which it seems as though our only way to judge things is as private individuals and within the framework of the values we can establish for ourselves, if anything else is really possible.
Oh, sure. a lot else is possible, but it requires the author to persuade his readers that there are important things other than themselves and that they are enduring things. Now, this may require that he be something of an evangelist, and this is a pedantic relationship, or rather a pedagogical relationship between reader and author that most people tend to shrink from. So, yes, I agree with you that this is a hindrance, this is an extra obstacle, but B, I disagree with you that it therefore becomes something that you can't handle. Chesterton handled it very well, so did C.S. Lewis.
Yes, but there's also this, that you can very well, as a novelist, or any one of us, in all our occupations, can make the most very good, perfect world for ourselves and achieve the reforms we want and really get everything. Unions of everything, other people of everything, all groups get what they want. And if it's an outside influence strong enough to come in or change or take over or menace, you will have nothing. This has been proven in the history of Europe in the last 30 years more. Czechoslovak is the recent one.
Mr. Gaynor.
Yes, Mr. Auchincloss. Do you think that with the advent of mass culture, people are more inclined to read nonfiction, since in most cases it provides the reader with immediately digestible information while not requiring him to exercise his imagination greatly?
Well, I don't. I'd love to have a good breakdown on the sale of the paperbacks that we were talking about earlier, because I suspect that with mass culture, the novel is going to do fairly well, and that it's the more limited audience, the so-called trade book audience, that is going heavily in for nonfiction at the moment. Don't know at all about that, but I can imagine that novels, when they get back to be entirely available at pocket price, will hit the big mass. I think probably have.
Mr. Greenfield?
Maybe an odd question, but it's to both of you. And
almost predictably an odd question.
Right. In spite of that, I'll be nice. If there was a novelist, there were a novelist, I'm not going to be right, that you could have at your disposal now that is no longer living, to look at the world today and use what talents he has with it, who would you choose?
Balzac.
Dostoevsky.
Mr. Buckley?
Dostoevsky. Yeah.
Then it's Balzac.
I'll go. Who would you choose?
I don't know. I'm an ahistorical leftist, you know, so my prejudice is...
Oh, leftist, really.
Right, sorry. My prejudice is toward the people writing today. That's why I attempted to engage the two of you, three of you, in that sense, because I think, in a way, I'm getting more out of the way Norman Mailer writes about the turmoil around us than I have certainly out of any modern novelist. And I agree with you, that's not the novel, it is something separate.
They didn't call it a new name.
All right,
start
it's
something
personal
new.
Journalism.
Why not?
Personal journalism,
but,
yeah, yeah.
But I do have the sense very definitely after reading Armies of the Night, you know, that
In Cold Blood was also Pentagon. That type.
Yes, but I don't think as much of it.
Which one?
In Cold Blood.
Capote's
In Cold Blood, yeah.
The Roman doesn't call those novels.
No, I know. That's my point is that what Mailer is doing, whatever you want to call it, the non-novel, is telling us more about our times than any novelist around now.
Depends what novels
you read. And you think more than Mailer's novels?
Yes.
More than The American Dream, mm-hmm. or Why Are We in Vietnam? But even more than Naked and the Dead.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's necessarily so, because I think that Norman Mailer is a great artist and a terrible reporter. I say this quite seriously, that there are few pleasures to match the pleasure of reading what Norman Mailer says about a particular thing, but it has absolutely no relation to what happened.
I hadn't aware that you'd been busted in the March on the Pentagon. I look forward to your account.
Well, I mean, but I was at San Francisco in 64, and that isn't the way it was. But it's a pleasure to read about it as being that way.
But it's not only a factual recording, it's a record of the sensibility of our time. And in that sense, it's very valid.
All of his membranes are open, you see, and this makes things pretty confusing.
And there are other media, too, nowadays, too, in certain aspects of television, etc., and if a new developing use of television, which would satisfy all the things you seem to want from a novel, and I would want more.
What is that?
I think it's that a novelist is someone who's...
In control of the situation.
Control of a story with a large canvas, and it's laid in, not just in Little Doolittle or something, but in situations is dealing with the great issues of our time.
But Bill suggests that Mailer is in charge of his story. Suggests that he is in charge of a story, that he invents it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, he invents it, definitely.
Yeah.
But
that doesn't mean he's in charge. He hasn't
removed that. Is it a novel, if that's true?
Yeah.
But you're using a historical background that is as true as you can get it. And whether it's contemporary history, or you're writing about 50 years ago or 100 years ago. But you write about contemporary history, but you must be accurate, and you must be very sure that you're not really putting your own political prejudices into the background.
Oh, I think as long as you declare your interest, there's nothing wrong with that. As long as one knows the frame of reference.
That could be.
The sense is that when Mailer gets himself into whatever state it is that enables him to write that way, and it's an impressionistic view, it's probably not as accurate as the Times nor even the National Review, certainly, but that there is something communicated about the flavor of what is going on that I, as one who likes novels, have not found in a modern novelist that I can think of. His description in two pages of what it is that this youth thing is all about is... in two pages just distills it all down.
Talking about the youth thing, I read more non-fiction than I read novels, actually, so I've been at a disadvantage when we're talking about recent novels here, or at least just immediate ones. But there is a book coming out this year by two young people from Britain, a journalist, and who have been over and been talking with the youth movement in France. And it's called Black Flag, Red Flag.
Excellent
book.
Not a novel.
No, not a novel, again, you see. But that's the kind of background I think is important to be in novels. Not the whole thing, it's impossible, it's too enormous. It deals with the extraordinary number of organized leaders.
Well, are we really just talking about the utility of the two techniques in the complementary work?
Yes.
For instance, Tom Wolfe.
Yes.
Obviously has the skills of the novelist. I mean, the current Tom Wolfe. Yeah. Does he not? Otherwise, it would have been impossible, I think, for him to make that extraordinary achievement. But the imagination, really what you're saying is this the first time in which a novelist's imagination can be put to nonfiction? And the answer is it can, but it doesn't end up being quite exactly nonfiction. It becomes something that is sifted through imagination, in the same way that Professor Butterfield said that all history really is personal.
Oh. Right. It's just this acknowledgement now, which is so important and which makes what's being done in nonfiction so readable and so important to him.
And it is his own individuality anyway.
It's his admission, and that's of the eye of the writer.
And all authors are different. They are. They have to be, or else then you get the novels that no one ever reads because they're just echoes.
And yet the two novels I can think of that have really excited people of my age, one is Catch-22, and the other is forthcoming. It's Philip Roth's novel, Portnoy's Complaint, which is, you know, in the form of the confession to the psychiatrist.
How can you say it has excited people your age when it's not out yet?
Because, no, Mr. Buckley. Unfair, major portions have appeared in New American Review twice, and Esquire and Partisan Review.
Oh. Well, what would you say the two complimentary novels were of a generation ago?
I don't know. I don't presume to make that judgment.
Well, from your general knowledge of things. Catcher in the Rye, for instance. Is that so? Would you say that was as influential a novel in its time as anything recently published?
Catcher in the Rye, an influential novel?
Mm-hmm.
Very popular novel. I don't know whom it influenced.
Other novel writers.
Do you think so? A few.
Good
well,
night.
You have the same. You have the same passion always. If something succeeds, there are people who imitate.
Yeah, that's it. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Good night.